Virginians have always stood at the crossroads of the fight for freedom. It is a battle in which we all reap the benefits. World War II was the defining event of the 20th century. It involved 60 countries. Over 57 million people were killed. The nuclear age was launched, and the United States emerged as the world's most powerful nation. World War II was fought in two major theaters of operation, the North African, Mideastern, and European theater, and to the Far East, the Asiatic Pacific theater. Following the sneak attack on Pearl Harbor in 1941, the Japanese swept across the South Pacific, bringing their domination to within 200 miles of Australia. During the next 4 years, the United States and her allies battled north toward Japan. One of these battles was for the tiny island of Iwo Jima.
Iwo Jima was extremely important because they had two airfields on Iwo with a third one under construction. Well, those planes on Iwo, they would go up and harass their B-29s on their way to Japan, and then they were waiting for them on their way back. And of course, they jumped on the cripples and everything, and a lot of those guys, they couldn't make it back, and they'd have to land in the sea. But with Iwo, they had a place to land.
Middle part of January, we headed off for Iwo. Of course, we didn't know we were going to Iwo until we were almost there. It took us about 3 weeks to zigzag across the ocean, and then he broke out this pork chop, like a shaped island, you know, so that's where we're going. It's going to be a cakewalk. How wrong they were.
Iwo, the island, was a volcanic island that went deep, and these big battle wagons could almost come up ashore because of the depth of the water there. They'd come up and they'd point blank with those 16-inchers and bam, into the side of Suribachi, and they were dropping napalm and strafing, and boy, we all said, well, there won't be anything there when we get there, you know.
So they had bombed that thing for I don't know how many days, bombed it and the new ships, Sheldon and what have you, they hadn't made a dent in it, really.
They had tunneled Iwo from one end to the other. They had escape routes. They had hospitals underground. There wasn't a building on the island. And there was 20-some thousand Japanese. They lived underground.
They had a lot of artillery on there, a lot of mortars. And, like, that was Japan's home country. I mean, you know, the mayor of Tokyo is also the mayor of Iwo Jima. That's all considered Japanese, had been Japanese for like hundreds of years. And they had been fortifying it for years and years, and they told us when they were laying out the battle plan, 5 days and it would be over, but it just didn't turn out. They didn't know that they had all those caves were there and how well they were fortified, and we didn't get the preliminary bombardment from the Navy that we were supposed to have gotten, and we didn't get the Air Corps bombers, that as much of it as the commanding generals were asking for. And I know like they wanted like 9 days of preliminary, we only got three. And then on the day of the invasion, the target was obscured. You didn't drop anything, you know, so. But I never understood that. The island was so small that, you know, if you dropped it, it was going to hit something that they had. I know once we got there, when they started shooting at us, it everything they fired would hit something. There were so many of us packed together on that little island.
I'll never forget. It was a beautiful day in February, 45. As far as the eye could see to the horizon, nothing but U.S. Navy ships and boats coming in. Literally thousands of small boats and ships descending on this small island.
The landing itself was scheduled for 9 o'clock. So naturally that morning we were up to have breakfast and get our gear ready and everything.
One of the traditions of the Marine Corps, the day before the invasion, they give you steak and eggs for breakfast at 3 a.m. Well, you're so scared you didn't amount to a whole lot. We hit the beach and immediately started unloading supplies, and it was relatively quiet.
We land right in about the middle between Suribachi and the stone quarry, which is the high ground on the right. While we were landing, there was hardly any incoming at all. Them suckers waited. Everybody was on the beach, all crowded on the beach. Not very big, you know, big island, and had two divisions. 5th Division going up toward Suribachi, and we were going up toward the other end of the island. And then they got us.
That night, all hell broke loose. They started throwing mortars and strafing the beach.
And on the flying bridge, about 100 yards off Red Beach, with 12 power binoculars, you could pick out everything that was happening on the beach, which was a horrendous day because they just wiped out the first wave of Marines going in. And I was up there and could pick out hand-to-hand fighting and the tanks and the flamethrowers, everything was happening on the beach area. So that was an unbelievable experience.
The Japs were great at camouflage. And you'd see the gun fire, that'd be the first time you'd see it. And then you could, if you looked real quickly, you could see them hauling the gun back. And we found out later that some things were mounted on railroad tracks, some of them.
And they were excellent mortar people. They had a little mortar they called a knee mortar. Our mortars had plates and had sights and all these things that they put a little base in the ground, and they put it between their legs and put a hand grenade in it, or whatever, you know, these mortars. And they played havoc on us. And we had no cover, you know.
I remember getting up, starting out, and bingo.
My whole leg was sort of missing, it was sort of hanging there, you know. And I was thinking to myself, I said, here I am, this is my second Purple Heart. I'm getting off this place, and I ain't gonna make it.
We was on LST, so they just dropped the front, and we drove off. And of course, water come up in the truck. I was a truck driver, and water come up in the floor of the truck about a foot. And we just barely got ashore, and they says, dig in here. And I was an old farm boy. I thought I knew how to use a shovel, but I could move more sand there with a spoon than most people could with a shovel.
The island was a volcanic island and had volcanic cinder. It wasn't sand. And you try to dig a hole, a foxhole is like digging a hole in a wheat bin. You know, it caved in on you. You couldn't get any depth. There was no cover, and they just threw mortars in, and of course, Suribachi, they were looking right down at us.
I was scheduled to go ashore on the third day, and so I was kind of taking it easy, watching it from the ship. Here come a guy running down the landing deck of the LST, hollering, Reeks, get your gear, you're going ashore. And that was like it, something afternoon on the first day. Fighting was so severe at that time, they called for everything else that they could get ashore at that moment.
They couldn't get ashore. Every time they'd start going ashore, they'd just mow them down. And you can't believe how many dead Marines was on the sand and floating in the water.
It looked like another world. And when you hit the beach, you became a part of that world. Like I say, it might be a blessing that you don't remember everything.
In We were under almost constant Japanese air attack. And this is where the kamikazes first became a known factor as far as we were concerned. And they would normally come in the latter part of an afternoon as dusk was approaching. There was no defense, really. Once these things from a distance aimed at your ship with a wide open throttle with the Japanese pilot absolutely looking forward to committing suicide and to simultaneously destroy the enemy. It was tough.
We also shot a twin-engine bomber that crossed our bow trying to hit the Enterprise aircraft carrier. And that was his mistake going across the bow because 4 5-inch guns could bear on him right away, 2 twin and 2 quad 40 millimeters. And we hit him and there was not a solid piece coming down. It was all floating.
Of course, the only thing that made it possible for us to take Iwo successfully was the flame-throwing tanks. The way we worked on that, the flamethrowers, when we finally got them in, they, you know, lay down a napalm in front of us, and we'd move right up 15 or 20 yards, dig in, and then he'd do another one. And so that napalm made it possible for us to take it out.
So the famous icon of the raising the flag at Iwo Jima happened right there, Suribachi.
We did salvage. They tried to make salvage ships out of pulling stuff off the beach. The whole beach was littered with wreckage of small, you know, LCVPs, jeeps, tanks, you name it.
The beach, the whole area, was covered with body parts. One of the most vivid things that I remember of the last days on the island, we came across an area where it looked like it had been raked clean, but there was one hand reaching up out of the sand like it was grasping for life.
As history shows, the Japanese just fought viciously as well as vigorously, so that our ultimate taking over Iwo lasted weeks more than had been anticipated. And of course there were far, far more losses, both within the ship range as well as, by all means, the personnel, the Marines. It was dreadful. It was terrible.
So if you ever meet a second lieutenant who's on Iwo, you can just say he's a lucky son of a gun. You know? That's about the size of it, you know? Because not many of them got off there.
I think like about 6,000 Marines were killed, about 18,000 wounded, so it was a pretty good, they did a pretty good toll. From then on, once we took Iwo, those P-51s could escort the B-29s to Japan and back out again. And I think it was like, I think it was roughly like 10 guys on a B-29, and I think like about 2,500 of them made emergency landings at Iwo Jima. So they credited the island with saving about 25,000 lives of Air Corps pilots, I mean crew, that would otherwise have landed in the Pacific Ocean.
You know, I say, you see these movies of John Wayne and all that, Sands of Iwo Jima and all that, Gung Ho, and that's a lot of more luck of it. To me, the definition of courage is when you're scared to death and yet you continue to do what you're supposed to do. To me, that's courage.